Is it a painting? Is it a photo? I don't know, but it just goes woo! Hi, it's me. This is actually a topic I'm really excited for. I actually work for a company that produces lenses and manufactures them, so I guess I could say I'm a bit of an authority on this, so let's just get straight into it. So while there are a lot of elements that make up the optical look of a lens, the two most prominent would be focal length and depth of field. So what we're going to do is look at those and how we can accurately replicate those effects in our art. It can get a bit complicated, you know, we're dealing with light here. So we're going to start with the theory, then link that to a real example, and then from there, go into art. Let's get to it. Put simply, focal length is the distance or the length between the sensor and the point in the lens at which the image becomes focused, known as the optical center. Focal length determines a lens's field of view and subsequent distortion and how compressed the image looks. Because we're describing distance, it's measured in millimeters, with smaller numbers having a wider field of view and less magnification, and larger numbers having a narrower field of view but greater magnification. Both wide and telephoto lenses produce distortion, with wide lenses distorting in a convex way in what is known as barreling, and telephoto lenses distorting in a concave way in what is known as pincushioning. Here's a very wide lens, a 6mm fisheye, demonstrating that barreling effect. But notice how it also seems to be protruding towards us in a 3D sense as well. That's because focal length determines how compressed an image looks in what is known as lens compression. Wide lenses make things that are far appear further and things that are close appear closer, increasing the apparent distance in the image. Here's a slightly tighter lens, a 24mm for comparison. That's why your phone makes your forehead look really big and your landscape photos look really small and underwhelming. It's all because of the wide lens. Whereas telephoto lenses compress the image more. Take a look at the comparison between a 14mm, a 50mm, and a 75mm, paying particular attention to the apparent depth of the background and the general compression in the image. You'll be able to see that in the 14mm, the distance is significantly elongated, with the hand looking quite distorted, whereas in the 75mm, the hand looks much more normal. Wide-angle looks can be great for creating a sense of scale or for creating dramatic, intense, or comedic feelings. Bringing this concept into art, Clip Studio's most recent update has included an awesome fisheye ruler that you can use to easily realize a wide-angle look. However, it can still be difficult to get the correct degree of distortion and lens compression for characters and objects in the fisheye scene, so you can use the perspective function in the object editor to make the 3D model more wide or more telephoto, to match the pre-existing focal length. And as we all know, when you start with art, you start with a cube. So here you can see me using the perspective function to adjust my table to match the reference image for a wide angle and telephoto look. However, if you need to apply a wide or telephoto effect to an image after the fact, you can use the distort function in the filter menu. Fisheye creates a wide angle look, whereas pinch, remember pin cushioning, creates a telephoto look. It's not a perfect fix, but it can be quite convincing if you remember our key principles around lens compression and increase or decrease the background depending on what focal length you're using. This could be a great tool for backgrounds or for doing concepts and thumbnails in a quick and easy way. And for more micro or accurate adjustments, I found that using the liquify tool, specifically the expand function for barreling and the pinch function for pin cushioning, to be helpful. Depth of field. Or DOF for short, is how in focus the background and foreground are when something is in focus, usually the subject. Deep depth of field is generally when the subject and the background are relatively in focus, such as the example I've got now. Whereas a shallow depth of field will mean only the subject will be in focus with the background and foreground out of focus, such as this example here. With a very shallow depth of field, only a small section of the image will be in focus. Overall, depth of field is really just about how lens focuses. Most artists probably have a base familiarity with depth of field. You know, you get your subject, you get your background, you slap some Gaussian blur on that baby, and I'm here to tell you that that's an oversimplification. Because by that logic, photos should look like this. So then how do we do it correctly? Let's take a look at how a lens focuses. And it's all to do with distance. So here we've got our camera, and it's looking at the mountains in the background at infinity, which is basically just really far away. There's some trees in the middle ground, let's say they're 20 meters away, or 65 feet for Americans, and Ben in the foreground 10 meters away, or 32 feet. A deep depth of field would mean that everything from about 10 meters to 20 meters would be in focus, and everything outside of those bounds would be out of focus. It's called deep because the focus is extending deep into the image. However, a shallower depth of field might mean only Ben is in focus and nothing else, like in this image here. The distance that the focus is covering is much shallower, hence the name. Now let's say that I moved Ben really close to the camera, and now he's only 1 meter away, or 3 feet. This might mean that the lens will be only able to focus on a section of Ben. See how only one side of the subject here is in focus? So depth of field is about how much of the image over a distance is in focus, but is also relative to how close the subject is to the camera, with closer subjects producing more defocused backgrounds. But we're not ready for Gaussian blurring yet, because there's a relationship between the focal length and depth of field. The longer the lens, generally the shallower the depth of field, whereas wide-angle lenses have a deeper depth of field. So when you're doing your fisheye scenes, remember that meaningful depth of field only occurs in wide lenses when the subject is close, like in your face close. And you can see that this example is a 14mm, so imagine what it would look like on a 6mm. Now let's say we put something in front of Ben, like a fence, maybe half a meter away from the camera. So now we've got something that's before what's in focus as well. But the focus doesn't just cut off and then the background is blurry. There is a transition, a graduation from in focus to out of focus, and this is known as focus fall off. The focus falls off. With a shallow depth of field, you'll find that the rest of Ben's body will begin to blur into the background, not completely out of focus, but not in focus either. And just like with your eyes, the thing really close to the camera, the fence, will become so defocused that it begins to become translucent. So breaking this down with a real example, here we've got a telephoto lens with a very shallow depth of field that's only focusing on a narrow plane in 3D space. Only what is bang on that narrow 10 centimeter mark is in focus. And you can see that because the flower stem is further away from us, even that is not in focus. So since depth of field inherently involves 3D space, it is a great way to add dimension and texture to your art. Lastly, just as a, you know, general rule of thumb, you'll also find that images are most sharp in the center of the picture, with the outsides generally a little softer. It can be hard to imagine just how defocused the background should be, so I'll include a link in the description to a depth of field simulator that you can use as reference. So how do we apply these concepts and go from this to this? Let's break it down. Having a look at our reference image, as I've talked about before, depth of field means, and focus fall off means that not everything will be in focus all at once, and it all depends on how far away it is from the camera. If I was to take a cross section of this, we've got our camera, we've got a cherry blossom in front, which is this one here. I'll do in blue actually. We've got a cherry blossom in front, which is this blue one here. Then we've got our cherry blossom and our bee, which is this here. Okay. And then we've got our back cherry blossom just behind that, which is here. And then we've got the rest of the tree, which I'll do in green. You know, the tree, which is all of this stuff around here. And because the depth of field is so shallow and you're really only basically dealing with, say, this much here, like that's all that's in focus, you've got to show that that graduation of the focus falling off around these edges with these, you know, these curved lines that I've done. I just want to reiterate that I'm not teaching you how to paint this particular reference. It's just that I've tried to find a reference that demonstrates all of these concepts. So remember to adapt these techniques and theory into your own works. For techniques, we're going to be using a lot of the blur and blend tool, airbrushing, the soft erasure and Gaussian blur in conjunction to create the levels of focus in this reference. So let's go from back to front. And since the background is so out of focus, you only need to focus on values and hue. So just really what I mean is blob in the colors and blend them together. I'm using a watercolor style brush because I really like the way that it blends and the sort of heaviness and weight to it, but you do you. Once you've got it in a good place, go to filter, blur, Gaussian blur, and defocus the background. For objects in the far middle ground, like the branches of the tree, just paint out the form with the middles of the shapes darker to help create that focus fall-off effect. You really want the edges of the brush to have a lower opacity, which will help that effect along. Apply Gaussian blur again to a lesser degree, and then use the blur tool and the soft eraser to continue that defocusing in the parts of the branches which are further away. When it comes to applying depth of field to objects in the middle ground, you want to go section by section, with the strength of the Gaussian blur dependent on how far away each petal is in this instance. After this has been applied, you can go back in with a soft airbrush on low opacity to help bring more emphasis to lines and forms that need them, such as these stamens. You'll also see in the reference image that there is a kind of blobbing happening in the vaguely focused areas, a kind of bokeh effect, and you can recreate this with a G-pen on a very low opacity by just making lots of little dots or outlining in a ghosting effect like on the flower. Now we're up to our subject, but notice that only the areas circled in orange are truly in focus. Just like with the middle ground, go section by section using the airbrush and soft eraser, both on low opacity, to finish the effect. If you find at any point that the subjects are lacking definition, adjust the contrast. I also found manually blurring with the blur tool very helpful for precise adjustments. Just make sure that it doesn't smear your work. Make your finishing touches and you're done. How did you find the tutorial? Let me know in the comments below. If you have any questions, please ask, because as you can see, this is a topic I'm passionate about. Anyway, thanks for being here.